wake up in the daylight.
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 It's very interesting mix indeed. Thank you so much for coming in to speak to us this evening, Cees. We're lovely to have you. Let me just ask you, coming out of that very short clip, what made you combine the idea of the two media in order to get your message out?
Well, I wanted to do something different, and I thought that the political conversation was quite stale, particularly as it relates to young people, and I wanted to excite young people's imagination about political ideas. And I knew that hip-hop was a phenomenon in South Africa. If we could use hip-hop to reflect on the country's woes and potential future solutions, then we could really spark a new debate among young people.
Your book is interesting for all sorts of reasons, and let's start off with some of the issues, and I really am skirting them because it's a very detailed book indeed.
Sure.
But as a democratic country with an advanced constitution, we imagine ourselves to be free, are we?
I think it's a mixed bag. If you look at the so-called progress that we claim to have made, a lot of that progress is insecure, a lot of it has been reversed, and I think the lie that we've been sold is that just because we've got the vote, somehow automatically our society will solve itself. And it might not. We might just fail, even if we've made initial progress. And that's a scary situation in which to be, one that I feel we're skirting dangerously close towards.
I want to ask you about this issue of progress and having a good story to tell. Many would argue the ANC's progress has perhaps been a bit slow, but it is to be considered progress nonetheless.
Well, I think that's what the people in power right now would like us to believe. Yes, there have been bumps in the road, but look at the big picture, everything's fine. The first chapter of my book seeks to dispel that notion. I mean, let's look at the economy that we live in. Unemployment is higher than it was in 1994. Inequality and poverty are all on the rampage, higher than 94. So what kind of progress is that when we're worse off than we were under a system that was a crime against humanity? And when we look at questions like service delivery, in the book I show that even in questions like housing, electrification, water and sanitation, the so-called gains actually unravel when you really look at them closely. So I think we need to stop the self-congratulation and look ourselves squarely in the mirror and realize that we've failed.
Cees, well, let's talk about Fees Must Fall, because I imagine it's as personal to you as it is to other students. Government tells us it's simply not possible in the current economic climate. Do you buy that?
I don't buy that, and in fact, I set about to deconstruct the notion that free education is unfeasible. And when you really look at the numbers, I argue that not only is it feasible, but it's relatively affordable, given the other amounts of money that we're putting towards infrastructure, say a trillion rands. Free education is relatively unaffordable, and it's about time that instead of instituting commissions and dragging our feet, we just did something different. And part of this book and this album is to try and resuscitate new ideas, try alternatives, because we've been trying the same things for 23 years, and these are the results we've got. It's time to be bold and to experiment with new solutions.
I want to talk about state participation in the economy, because this for me was one of your most interesting chapters.
Right.
People give examples of Eskom, of SABC and SAA, and say look what a hash government has made of these state institutions. Surely the private sector should get involved at this point.
Well, that is true. In fact, part of the problem with our state is how poorly it's managed state-owned enterprises. But what I try to say in the book is that there's no necessary reason why state ownership should be a problem. And in fact, if we're going to build ourselves out of this crisis, we need the state to play an important role. But what I think has been lacking is details about how that might work. So what I trace in the book is the creation of a national wealth fund, which would essentially consolidate all of government's assets into a single fund. Think of property, for example. Just the state property portfolio alone is a tremendous asset that government isn't using. And I show that if we could just increase the asset on state property by 1%, that would be like a 4% tax increase. So we do need to use the state, but we need to use it in wise ways that conform with international best practice. And I don't think that those debates are as developed as they should be in South Africa.
One of the 10 myths you tackle in this book as well is the issue of racism. You've used this beautiful metaphor that I enjoyed very much of a home in which white South Africans initially enjoyed the best rooms and black South Africans got the crummiest, essentially.
Right.
Why is it not enough for black South Africans simply to be able to move into the best rooms? Why does the architecture of that home need to be changed?
Well, if we continue with the metaphor, let's say 94 was this house where white South Africans were in the best rooms, black South Africans were in, you know, the terrible rooms. One way of changing things is to put black South Africans in the rooms that white South Africans occupied, but that wouldn't make the house's structure any more fair, and there'd still be a lot of people who didn't make it into those rooms. The thing is, we need to change the very structure of our society. And I think all too often we get fixated on private racist beliefs as if that's the real problem. But what I argue in the book is we can have racism even if we don't have racists. And it's in fact the structures of our society, the economic distribution and how that's racially skewed, that we need to attack, whether or not people hold private racist beliefs.
It's interesting the way you've worked that into private schooling that we know has been exposed in so many ways in terms of racism in this country. I think your chapter on private schools will resonate strongly with many black parents like yours, like your dad, sure, who's been through great hardship, wanted to give his son the best education, and with the best intentions, put him into a school like St. John's, where you made several discoveries about what the school was really about. If racism has gone underground at these institutions, what do we do as black parents? Do we say, this is a poor choice for our children, and therefore we won't be party to it? Or do we say, let's move into those spaces and revolutionize them?
Well, I think it's tempting to think we should just boycott all of these spaces, but I think that would be a mistake, because we actually have to ultimately work in tandem. We need to build new institutions, but at the same time, we also need to ensure that the current institutions that we have transform. If we don't do that, we fall victim to essentially creating a new kind of separate development where we leave untransformed institutions to do what they want and try to build new nascent institutions. I think we need to do both at the same time. And that's why places like St. John's or universities who are still steeped in apartheid culture need to be challenged. And in the album, I have a line that says, that's what I call a post-apartheid irony. When you get ahead, they take you back to their binaries. And I think that's the situation that a lot of black South Africans are in. Every time you think you're getting ahead, you see a new racism rearing its ugly head.
Sizwe, your chapter on media freedom in our country is interesting, and I read it twice.
I'm sure you did. Yeah.
Because being a part of it obviously makes you want to question the institutionalized nature of it.
Right.
Why is it that you don't believe the media is actually free in this country, despite all our constitutional precepts and the like?
Right. Well, I think that's a big myth that, you know, the media acts as this watchdog in our democracy. And despite the fact that everything's going so badly, at least we have a free media. Do we really, though? When you look at ownership patterns in the South African media, things have changed at the managerial level. But when you really look at who owns the media, I think we're caught in a vice grip between state control and corporate control. And I often feel that the truth lies somewhere in between. And so the state blames the corporate control, and the corporate control blames state control. But in actual fact, I still think there's a great room for independent media in South Africa to strengthen our democracy.
Hold that thought, Sizwe. We're just going to take a short break. When we come back, we'll be tackling this issue of the media and media freedom in South Africa on a little more of a deeper level with Sizwe Mpofu-Walsh. Stay with us.
You back in the Fortuna 4x4 Challenge.
I'm the one to back.
Back your hero and you could win a Fortuna. Enter now.
Have you ever looked for a hotel online? Did you notice that there are so many different prices out there for the exact same room? Well, Trivago does the work for you and instantly compares the prices of over 600,000 hotels from over 200 different websites. Instead of searching for hours or spending too much, Trivago makes it easy for you to find the ideal hotel for the best price. Trivago shows you all the different prices for the exact same room. And that's how you can be sure that you find your ideal hotel for the best price. Hotel Trivago.
Getting into the tail end of our conversation with writer and hip-hop artist Sizwe Mpofu-Walsh, who's in studio with us, discussing his book and album, Democracy and Delusion. Sizwe, just to pick up on that idea about media freedom in South Africa, I liked this idea that you say, although we have a plurality of views in the South African media, that doesn't necessarily mean we have a diversity of opinion.
That's true. I think all too often we confuse plurality, and we do have a diverse media space with different opinions. And all too often, I think that the status quo, the policies that we've pursued over the last 23 years is reinforced in our media, even though there are lots of different voices. And often, ironically, if you have lots of different voices saying the same thing, that convinces citizens that there's no other alternative. So what I think that means is that as South Africans, we need to propose new solutions, but particularly as young South Africans who will inherit this future, we need to challenge orthodoxy, challenge ideas that are supposedly set down from heaven, and begin to chart our own future and disagree with some of the narratives that we've been spun.
You know, it's interesting indeed that you are a very young person. You're a very well-educated person. I mean, you're doing your PhD at Oxford at the moment.
Sure.
Having said that, there are still people watching this interview who would look at you and say, this guy's still quite young. He's wet behind the ears.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm a seasoned politician. How can he tell me what to do? Why do you think that is such a difficult intergenerational dilemma, the fact that older politicians, older members of society struggle so much to listen to the voice of the youth, even when you are saying pertinent.
Are in a position to actually affect change. But one of the things I really want to show with this project is that the only way we're going to dig ourselves out of this crisis is if we start listening to young people. We have ideas, we have views on how the future of this country should go, but the doors are closed and people are hogging this political space and they're tired, they're out of ideas, and they're not going to take us anywhere soon. So difficult as it is in the South African climate, I think it's high time that young people started a new conversation, and what I hope this book and album will do will be a weapon in the hands of young people who can really understand the country, take a bird's eye view, and then start a conversation about how we chart the way forward.
You've certainly gone about it in a very intriguing way. Thank you so much for coming in to talk to
Thanks
us.
Thanks so much.
Sizwe, lovely to have you with us. Rapper, author and activist, Sizwe Mpofu-Walsh. Plenty more of the day's top stories at 5:30. Stay with us on Afternoon News.